don't know why, but there's somebody here that's having a time with love tonight, and God said for me to stop what I'm preaching and preach to you.
And he loves you.
And I preached about 10 minutes on that and gave an altar call, and people just filling up the altars. And one of the ushers came and got me, and he said, there's a man in the back who wants to talk to you, and they had some Sunday school rooms in the, where you come in the front, like we have the nursery and the little office. They had some little rooms, and I said, well, who is it? He said, it's a guy in a camouflage suit with his hat turned backwards. I said, I saw him. He said he has to talk to you now. I told two of them, I said, get another usher, and y'all come with me. I said, if you stand outside that door, and if I holler, help, y'all bring that lock and come in. And I walked in and knocked at the door, and he opened the door, and I walked in, and he shut the door, and he locked it. Now, why did I say that if y'all hear me holler, help break the lock? I don't know why, but I just said it. And that man looked at me and he says, my wife left me this afternoon, took my three kids, and she's gone. She wants to divorce me. He said, she never loved me. I said, yeah, she had to love you. She gave you three children. Why did you preach on God is love? Why did you say this? I said that. Why did you say this? I said that too. I didn't know what I was saying, but God knew what he needed to hear. And that man fell on his knees in the middle of that room. And he said, I need that love. He crossed over. Can I go get the pastor? I said, I'm just a busy minister here today. I said, you need to meet the pastor. Do you live in this community? He said, yes, I do. And he finally consented for the pastor to come in, and I linked those two together. And I left that night. The following Wednesday night, the pastor called me and said, yes, who showed up? I prayed with him, Brother Zeno, and I told him, I said, if you'll get right with God, God will make your family whole again.
It will happen.
The pastor called me on Wednesday night and he said, guess who's here? I said, who? He said, that old boy in that camouflage outfit was here for the fellowship meeting. He's here tonight in that same camouflage outfit. He said, if there's a woman sitting beside him, beautiful woman. He said, and he got filled with the Holy Ghost tonight. We baptized him, his wife, and three children in Jesus' name. God knew what that man needed to hear. And God knows, it's amazing what your children need to hear. The word from God that will change their minds. Your children, brother, tell them, God knows what they need to hear for their mindset to change and come to God. Locking you in a room with me in Sims Ford, Louisiana.
Wasn't that the one?
I didn't recognize it. He had a long ponytail. He was real rough. He said, I want to introduce you to somebody. That's been 20 years ago.
Beautiful woman.
Yes.
He did this, and this beautiful lady walked up. He said, this is my wife that had left me, that drove me to that church.
That's right.
I said, it's so good to meet you. He said, she's a Sunday school teacher in the church. I said, well. He knows it, and a young lady, I think she's around 23 or 24, and a young man and a little girl in her arms came up. He said, this is one of my kids.
That's my
she
baby.
Took and left. He said, but they came back home. I said, I heard that. He said, God did exactly what you told me he would do if I got my life straight.
Right. He is
faithful.
God is faithful.
He is faithful. God bless you. We love you this morning. Praise God. We're so glad you're here. Good to have my buddy here this morning.
Yes. Amen.
So glad you're here this morning.
Yes.
Praise God. And we're thankful for all of you that are here. The ushers are coming. We're going to sing or do something. And they're going to take up the offering. Let's yield this unto the Lord. Praise God.
Jesus.
Hey. all the sorrow will all be worth it, because we'll walk through those
presentations.
We'll walk down those streets of gold, and we'll see Jesus face to face.
Oh my God.
So just hang on, because there's nothing here that you can go through that you are not able to bear, because it says it in God's word, and God cannot lie.
That's right.
If it's in the word, it's truth. So there is nothing that can cause you to walk away from God but you. You have to just reach out and touch Him, and know for a fact that He'll bring you through it all.
That's right.
We need a spirit filled teacher. Who prays?
Christ of the cross.
And we'll read verses 13 through 18.
Oh God.
Sunday night, after prayer, we went back home. Very tired, and I just took another shower. Showers relaxed. I just took another shower, and up again, and Spirit said, "You're not laying down already. So just stretch out here and relax."
Oh, my Jesus.
And I dozed off and went to sleep. She said, "I go to sleep faster than anybody she has ever known." But wives like to talk. They just do. They like to talk. You know, we're gone all day, and they want to catch up at night, and they want to talk.
Oh, my God, Jesus.
I sit there and listen as intent as I can, but I go to sleep. Don't mean to be rude. I go to sleep. And I dozed off to sleep, and the Lord woke me, I guess, about 11 o'clock. He says, "My people need to understand what's happening."
Oh, God.
And I said, "Lord, I need to understand what's happening.
Please explain it to all of me."
God began to deal with me, and kind of like Brother Zeno, if I don't write it down, I'll lose it.
What in the world is
going
on? It's
really real at the time He's giving it to you, but if you don't write it down, the next day it's not told, and you don't remember everything. So, and I have learned now how to use my phone in a more productive way. I just go and get a microphone and better write, and I record what God has said to me, so I can go back and review it. The Lord gave me Revelation chapter 9, verses 13 through 18. Believe in this end time hour that we're living in.
This is it.
God is going to keep His people abreast and aware of what's happening.
What's going on?
Verse 13 says, "And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altars, which is before God, saying to the sixth angel, which had the trumpet, loose the four angels which are bound in the great river of Euphrates." Verse 15 says, "And the four angels were loose, which were
prepared."
Everybody say prepared.
Prepared.
This is not something that just happened to drop in, but God has prepared
centuries
for the hour that we're living in. "And the four angels were loose, which were prepared for an hour, and a day, and a month, and a year." God knows exactly when everything is going to happen.
Going to be released.
He said, "A day, a month, and a year." So He knows when, exactly what month it's going to happen in. He knows exactly what day it's going to happen. And He knows what year. And He says, "Prepare for an hour and a day, a month and a year, for to slay the third part of men. And the number of the army of the horsemen were 200,000. That's 2 million.
And I heard
the number of them. And thus I saw the horses in the vision, and them that sat on them, having breastplates of fire
and of
chasen." That word chasen, I did not know what it meant, and when I looked it up, it means a glowing hot orange.
My God.
So that's what that means. Having breastplates of fire and a glowing as a hot orange and brimstone. And the heads of the horses were as the head of lions. Out of their mouths issued fire and smoke and brimstone. And by these three was the third part of men killed by the fire and by the smoke and by the brimstone which issued out of their mouths. I am not a prophecy teacher. share with you some things that God shared with me last Monday night. And I want to preach to you about the next great event. You can start looking for it. Look, if you're not already looking for it, I'm not talking about the rapture. Because what I'm going to preach to you about this morning has to happen
before
the rapture takes place. Let's pray. Lord, we realize this morning that we are living in the end time of the church age. We know that this world will go on existing for another 1,000 years after grace dispensation is completed. And we know, God, that if we are not filled with your Spirit and living holy, godly lives when the rapture takes place, we will not go. I pray now, Lord, for a spirit of conviction. I pray for a spirit of awakening in each of us. That we understand this morning, God, that things will not continue as they've always been. But here in Revelation 16, it said, you had a day, a month, and a year when this next great event would happen. And Lord, we need to be ready to meet you. Because according to your word, you said 1/3 of the human race, that's almost 2.6 billion people, are going to die in this next great event. And if we're not ready to meet you, we will spend eternity in hell.
That's a fact.
I pray that you open our eyes and our ears.
This is serious.
And walk these aisles this morning. And help us to understand that you are coming soon. We ask it in the lovely name of Jesus. And everybody say amen.
Amen.
God bless you. You may be seated.
Oh my God.
In what is the biggest military action against President Bashar Assad since the start of Syria's war 7 years ago, on April the 6th, the United States, the United Kingdom, and France came together in a coalition and bombed Syria. The airstrikes targeted, according to the news report, a research center outside the capital, Damascus, and 2 suspected chemical weapons storage sites near the city of Homs. This response, or action, was in response to the Syria attacking their own people with serum, which is a nerve gas that kills people. The Syrian government claims to have shot down many of the more than 100 missiles that were launched. And in Damascus, people there in Syria actually celebrated on the streets, honking their car horns in show of defiance. Russia, who is aiding and abetting Syria, said that this was an act of aggression and warns of consequences. The Word of God says when you hear of wars
and
rumors of war, do what? Look up your redemption draweth nigh. It's not this morning a matter of is there going to be a World War III? Because it's in your Bible. There in Revelation 16. There's not a 0.1% chance that it's not going to happen. Another World War is coming. the biggest world war ever.
That's the truth.
According to the Bible, one out of three people will die on the earth when this war of all wars comes. It's not a matter of if it's going to happen. It's a matter of when it's going to happen. The third part of men would be over 2 billion. Actually, it comes up to 2.7 billion people are going to die in that war.
Amen.
The Word of God said that He was going to loose the four angels who were in the Euphrates, and that when they loosed them, that fire and brimstone and the glow of orange. And I looked for it and I found it. I didn't get to. I wanted to put it on a jump drive. I just wanted you to look at what a nuclear bomb exploding
looks like.
It looks like just what John the Revelator spoke of here in chapter 16. Were you trying to scare us for the Bergens? No, I'm trying to get us to understand how close we are to the coming of the Lord. The coming of the Lord, and I have people ask me all the time, will the earth continue to exist after the church is taken out of here? And I said, yes, it will. We will move from one dispensation into the last dispensation.
My God.
We're living now in the dispensation called grace. A dispensation is a period of time where God deals with humanity. He tries to wake us up. He tries to draw us into the kingdom of God. But when this dispensation of grace ends, we will move into the dispensation of the millennial reign. Every dispensation, go back and research what I'm telling you, every dispensation, every period of time that God has dealt with man has lasted approximately 2,000 years. The dispensation of innocence, the dispensation of conscience, the dispensation, and it goes right on down and until you get to the dispensation of grace where we live. And then there will be the millennial reign, the dispensation of millennial reign. The only thing is, the church will not be here.
We won't be here.
I'm not talking about this building. This building will be here. But the church, which is the body of Christ, the church, which is you that have repented of your sins, been baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Spirit of God,
amen,
and spoke in another language that you had never learned, and are living holy and righteous. Because God said, be ye holy, for I am holy. And without holiness, no man shall see God.
Amen.
Salvation history, and indeed holds a prominent place in the history of human civilization. The name Euphrates is a Greek transliteration of the Hebrew word parat, P-A-R-A-T, which means fruitful, coming from the same Hebrew word as Ephraim. God has made me fruitful. The prefix EU in Euphrates means good or well. Thus, the Euphrates is the well-fruited river. The Euphrates was one of the original four rivers which watered the Garden of Eden.
Yes, sir.
And it is acknowledged even by secular scholars as being at the site of the very cradle of civilization. Various cities, early cities, state kingdoms abounded in and around this fertile crescent and between the two rivers, which was the Mesopotamia, which means between the rivers. The Sumerian, Akkadian, Babylonian, Assyrian, and Persian empires ruled at various times in history. And the area was traversed by various biblical figures at times. Abram became a Hebrew, one who crosses over. You know what Abram means in the Hebrew. Abram became a Hebrew when he obeyed God, leaving the Ur of Chaldees. God said, I want you to get your wife and you, and I want you to leave. I'm going to take you to a land that you have not worked for and every place that your feet touch. He said, I am going to give it to you. And he left Ur of the Chaldees and crossing the Euphrates to find the land God would give him and his seed forever.
Yes, Lord.
From the wilderness and Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, the whole land of the Hittites, and even unto the great sea toward the setting of the sun, shall be your border. You'll find that in Joshua chapter 1, verse 4. To thy seed will I give this land from the river of Egypt, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates. God's promised Abram that in Genesis 15 and 18. We're not going to take the time to get all these scriptures. Thou mayest abide to journey out of Egypt. Thou hast set out its shoots even unto the sea and its twigs unto the river. You'll find that in Psalms 88 and verse 11. The Euphrates is the true eastern border of the land that God allotted to Israel. They have never realized their full possession other than briefly in the days of David and Solomon.
Yes, sir.
Waves of distraught Jews had to make the sorrowful journey back across the Euphrates in the days of Babylonian captivity, including Daniel, Ezekiel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. These are names that you all understand. The waters of Babylon refers to the Euphrates.
Yes, sir.
By the river of Babylon, there we sat down and we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our hearts upon the willows in the midst thereof, for there they carried us away captive, required of us a song, and they wasted us, and required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion.
Wow.
How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land, was their reply. We need to understand this morning, in the book of Revelations,
my God, Jesus,
the Euphrates is revealed as being the location of four mighty destructive messengers. Bound for centuries, they have been there.
In that river.
John said they are reserved until the day and the month and the year that they are loose. They have not been able to do what they were designed to do because it was not right timing. When you begin to live for God, you have to understand God's timing is everything. We pray and it don't happen right then, and the devil says, well, see, the Lord lied. He didn't want to give you that. No, it's not time for it to be given. We need to understand that. I want that to get into your mind this morning. By the time the pent-up fury of these angels is spent, the scripture says one-third of all mankind will have been killed.
Wow.
I have always just thought of these angels as holy angels until Sunday night, waiting on the Lord. And he said, God began to talk to me. He said, I have been looking at this. And you've been looking at this, and I want you to understand something. These angels have been bound for a specific time.
My God.
Could these be territorial spirits?
Four demons.
Could they be territorial angels? What four countries are bordering the Euphrates River? We're going to take a look at that. These territorial spirits, the prince of Persia, the prince of and to chasten thyself before God. Thy words were heard, and I have come for thy words.
Wow.
But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 1 and 20 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the king of Persia. Consider the four nations through which the Euphrates runs to borders: Turkey,
Istanbul,
Syria, Iran, and Iraq. Consider the horrors and the carnage already unleashed upon these places just in the last 30 years. Look at the horrifying changes occurring in recent modern and even modern Muslim nations such as Turkey. Events are turning like quickly gathering black clouds on a hot midwestern summer day. The light is dimming and the sky turns dark as the winds pick up. Something terrible is about to be unleashed from this Euphrates area, which will end in near destruction of all life on earth.
My God.
1/3 of the human race will be wiped off of the map in one day. And what did John say? He talked about the sixth angel. He also talks about the seventh angel.
Yes, sir.
If we were to take the time to read it this morning, which I may do, I have it right here in Revelation 16, verses 13 through 17. Notice what he said. Why are you showing me this? Because I want you to understand the sixth angel is going to unleash these four spirits from the Euphrates, who has been bound for years, or boy could be released. It was the sixth angel that released them. But there's a seventh angel. And the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, "It is done." Next verse. And there were voices and thunder and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake such as was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. Next verse. And the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell. And great Babylon came in remembrance before God to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. Next verse. And every island fled away, and the mountains were not found. What he is talking about here is the battle of Armageddon. So the next great event that's going to come upon our earth is the event of the war that's going to destroy 1/3 of the human race. So the question is not, is there going to be a war?
There is.
But the question is when? The third part of men would be over 2.7 billion. We already talked about that. Prior to the 20th century, what century are we in?
The 21st.
We're in the 21st century. Prior to the 20th century, there had never been a war with 1 million fatalities. Then come World War I in 1914, 8.2 million people were killed. They call it the Great War, World War I. With the founding of the League of Nations, we had hoped that this type of carnage would never happen again. But just 20 short years later, World War II took place. And did anybody know how many died there? 5.2 million died in World War II, as if something had come or had been unleashed in the human soul. And the cry went out across America, how can we stop this?
My God.
With the founding of the United Nations, we had hoped that the situation of world peace was at hand. But I have the dreadful assignment this morning of telling you it is not fixed.
It's going to happen again.
It is not fixed. It's going to happen again.
That's right.
There will neither be 8 million dead or 52 million dead. This war that is coming 7 billion people. 40 times of World War II, and it will be the worst war ever. I can't tell you exactly when it's going to happen, but the Bible tells us that where World War III will originate, the sixth trumpet prophesies in Revelation 9, verses 14 through 15, saying that the sixth angel, which has the trumpet, will loose the four angels, which are bound in the great river Euphrates. And the four angels were loose, which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year to slay the third part of men. If you're sitting here this morning and you don't really know if you're right with God, I come as a watchman on the wall this morning to tell you, you need to make sure that you're ready to meet God. Because when this World War III breaks out, well, you're just a prophet of doom. No, I'm here to show you what God showed me. Out of the chaos and destruction, a strong leader will arise to promise peace and security. The Antichrist will step onto the world scene at just the right moment. He will provide firm direction, but he'll also demand absolute obedience. So there are four prophetic developments occurring right now that demonstrate how close we are to this Euphrates River War, otherwise known as World War III. Syria has been in the scene, has been having war and threatening war for the last 7 years. We have had several different city presidents of the United States, but their reign, it was not time yet. But we're living, and it may not be in the time of the president we have now. All we have to look at, he said, when you see the fig tree blooming, you know that spring is near. He said to the disciples, said, Lord, what signs will we need to look for? He said, this wicked and perverted generation. He said, they look for a sign. You know, if the bill's due on the 10th and we ain't paid it by the 20th, when somebody knocks the door, what do we do? We look for a sign. Is that a legal representative and they got a truck and their hands up the pole and they're telling me they reached a cut by electrician? He said this generation looks for a sign. They said, what sign? He said, there will be wars and rumors of war. He said, when you begin, he said, daughters against mothers and fathers against sons. And he said, all of these things are going to take place. And we see it every day. The signs have been here now for years. I am 65 years old, and for the last 65 years, I have been told that Jesus is coming. Well, that must mean that they know that just means I'm 65 years closer to the coming of the Lord. Well, Brother Murray, I'm going to live like the devil for the next 30 years. I'm just a young person, and then when I get old, I'll come live for God. Go ahead. I'm going to tell you what the Bible says. The person that says that is a fool. Is a fool. He said, I fool. Because the rich man said, my harvest has been good, and I'm going to build me some bigger barns, and I'm going to build me some bigger silos. And next year, and the Lord spoke to him and said, I fool. This night shall your soul be required of you. We got to quit playing around with God. We need to quit asking and going through the motions for God. We need to be on our face before God. Yeah. And we need to be crying out, God, is there anything in my life that would hinder me from going to heaven? God, if I put anything ahead of you, I want to repent of it, God. Show me what it is, and I will change. Because the next great event, I could be one of those that was taken out.
We're out of time. Hold on. We're out of time.
In Genesis 15 and 18, I think that's one of them I gave you.
My God.
In the same day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham, saying, unto thy seed, have I given this land from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates. God said, I'm not just giving it to you, but I'm giving it to your kids, your grandkids.
Your descendants.
If there's anything, I don't want to kill my kids and my grandchildren, Brother Donald. I want to kill them with the plan of salvation.
Yeah.
And I want to love it and understand it. Because Paul said in 2 Thessalonians, because you love my truth, I will send you a strong delusion. Make you believe that lie, and you shall be damned. Revelation 13:16-17 describes the
the control system which will be implemented during the reign of the Antichrist. Revelation 13, verse 16. And he called all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond. There won't be anybody excluded. To do what?
To receive a mark in their right hand
or in their forehead. I want you to understand, the technology is already implemented and there's people taking the chip. It's already being implemented. Is that the mark of the beast? I don't know, but the potential for him to do what he says here in this scripture is already in place. Verse 17.
And that no man might buy or sell.
You can have all the money you want in the bank, and it won't do you a single penny good. You can drive up to the restaurant and go in and order you a filet mignon, and when they come to get the bill, they will not take your cash. The scripture says that there will be a cashless society. Do you understand that we're almost there now?
The banks are bringing it
in. Is there anyone that does not have a card? A credit card? There's one. With a debit card, you can pay for your stuff. You can go to an ATM and get cash withdrawals. But it all has to be done with that card. We are living in that hour. He will cause every man, woman, boy, girl. I've had people tell me, I've taught Bible studies on this, and I've had families tell me, I've had moms say, there's no way I won't take that card, that mark. Turn and look at your babies.
Take a good look.
How many mothers would let your baby starve to death? You'll do what it takes to make sure that you have the ability. We need to understand. Anybody ever heard of the Real ID Act? Mandates that Americans produce federally approved identification upon demand. Although it is repeatedly postponed implementation penalties, the Department of Homeland Security has announced a gradual rollout for enforcing the law. The Affordable Act Care, often referred to as the Real ID, is disguised with a data hub and a unique patent identifier to verify eligibility. Chris and I was talking about that the other day. You know that the Homeland Security has more power
than ever before
than any other federal enforcement agency in the world.
More than ever.
They can pick you up and tell nobody where you're at.
Yep, at a moment's notice.
Supreme Court judges can send out laws saying you've got to release them, and they don't have to. This is the kind of people that are already here. The departments are already set up. Are you trying to scare me? No, I'm trying to get you to understand that the next great event, a war that originates from the Euphrates River, Middle East unrest, continues to boil in Libya, Iraq, and Syria, and Egypt, and Jordan, and is on the brink of expanding to a full-scale war that could involve the major world powers.
Yes, sir.
America, Russia. Analysts believe Syria may soon become a flashpoint, and it already has.
Yes, sir.
It already has become a flashpoint that would divide the region along a battle line drawn between Shia and Sunni Muslims. Iran is one of America and Israel's foremost enemies. And the Islamic Republic has become one of the most serious threats to stability in the Middle East. As Iran man is rapidly achieving nuclear capability and now knows that we know that they do. The region has become far more dangerous as the number of countries engaged in nuclear activity grows. The deputy commander of Iran's Revolutionary Guard has written that Tehran is able to destroy every spot in Israel. Germany views Iran as a potential threat, not just to Israel, but also to all the European countries.
Wow.
What it is an entrance ramp for the Antichrist.
Yes, sir.
World War III entrance ramp for the Antichrist details how this war is going to come out of the Euphrates River area, resulting in the killing of one-third of the human race. It's going to happen, and it will affect you and me and our families.
Wake up.
If you've ever reached for your kids, you need to reach them.
Before it's too late.
When they have the battle, you need to have buzzards that give an egg, two eggs. They may not one, but two. And that's been since 1917 on.
The Word of God says that this war, this battle of Armageddon, I have news clips, Time Magazine here, USA Today newspaper here. And the scripture says that the blood in that battle of Armageddon will be, we have to understand, there's a battle coming in the near future.
Yes, sir.
The next great event will be this battle called World War III. And it's going to affect us, our families, our nation, our world, everything. And it looks like it's coming sooner than we think. The Bible says that they will cry, peace, peace.
Yes.
But what?
Sudden destruction.
But sudden destruction. Come up the whole thing.
That's their answer.
You try to tell me that tomorrow? No, nobody knows. I had someone call me and said, man, I just read an article, and you need to read that, Brother Perkins. It says God is coming in 2019. I laughed. This was a preacher. I laughed at him. He said, what are you laughing about? I said, that ain't going to happen.
No man.
Scripture, I said, the scripture says no man, not even the angels in heaven, knows when the Son of Man will return to earth again. I said, so you just send me that link because I want to send a word back. And he did. He sent me a link from that story, and I read it. And I laughed most of the way through it because he kept saying, 2019 is coming, 2019. And so I just hit reply. And I gave you the scripture. Not even the angels in heaven knows when the Son of Man will return again. But he did say, we need to look up for our redemption draweth nigh. Syria is a power king. Iran is a power king. Iraq is a power king. Turkey is a power king. Those are the four nations that border the Euphrates River. We need to wake up and understand that God is coming back. Do I have to worry? If I didn't have the Holy Ghost, I would worry.
Yes, sir.
But do I act like I worry at night when I go to bed? I make sure everything is right between me and God.
That's right.
And then I close my eyes. And I said, Lord, if you take me there tonight, I'll see you in the morning.
I'll see you on the other side.
There's an old song that says, I will meet you in the morning. I will meet you in the morning. I will meet you
inside Eastern Gates.
You in the morning, I will breathe. and I go to sleep. But Jonah, I sleep so sound.
That's right.
Because there's no worry and there's no fear.
If you take speed, take
speed.
You can have your money. You can have your house.
The world.
Just give me Jesus. Because that's the only thing that's going to last. A man right down the street asked me one time, he said, what's going to happen to that church building if what you say is going to happen is going to happen? I said, I don't care.
I won't be here.
I said, the Antichrist can set up a ID station if he wants to. And those that miss the rapture probably won't come back here anymore. You're probably going to go wild and be dancing at the purple peacock. Because it won't do you any good
anymore
to seek for God if you miss the rapture of the church. The next remnant, according to Scripture, you go back and read it. You go back and research it. Don't take it. I'm trying to give you some of the Scriptures God gave me. I didn't give them all. But you need to take those down and go research it because it's going to happen. Let's go. So the most important question you need to ask yourself is, am I prepared? Am I ready?
Am I really ready
to meet God? And if God was to come in the next 30 seconds,
were you ready?
Are you ready?
Is your passport?
If you can't truthfully say that, and your spirit will let you know. Your spirit will let you know. You know if you've been obedient to the Word. You know if you've done what the Word of God said. If you can't honestly answer yes. And I'm not picking on Angela. She knows I love her. But I'm asking you, are you ready? And if you can't honestly answer, these altars are open. Today is the day of salvation. Say not tomorrow. It's today. Because tomorrow may never come. Tomorrow may never come. I was in the hospital the other day praying with somebody that was having surgery, about to have surgery. There was another family that came down the hall, as they know, and went over in the corner of that waiting room.
My God.
And they were in deep travail. I said, what's going on? I said, can I pray with y'all? Can I help you with something? They said, our daddy was just coming for a little minor surgery.
My God.
Doctor said 20 minutes they would be through. And preacher, he never woke up.
Oh God, he never got off the table.
They gave him anesthesia, put him out for 20 minutes, and he never woke up. That's how fragile life is. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Are you ready?
Oh God.
He's coming soon. There's no doubt. We're gonna leave this world with a shout. Sin will be gone. Things will be right. Keep looking up. We may come tonight.
I'm going home to Jesus.
If there's one praise of God inside of you, you need to get it. I want you to ask yourself that question with a sincere heart. Am I ready?
God!
Am I ready?
Help me!
Will you answer that sincerely?
Don't leave us down here.
Have I repented of my sins?
Don't leave me down here.
And after I repented, did I quit sinning? It does no good to tell God I'm sorry and go back and do it again. You did not repent. You only was sorry that God caught you. He said, repent. Be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. And you shall receive the Holy Ghost. Jesus told Nicodemus, unless you are born again of the water and the Spirit, you cannot enter or see the kingdom of God. That's not a United Pentecostal church. That's the Word of God.
That's right.
We don't want to be down here.
Brother Perkins, I love God. He said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. You'll repent, get baptized in Jesus' name, be filled with my Spirit, live holy and righteous if you love me. That's not the United Pentecostal Church. That's the Word of God. I asked you this morning, with every head bowed and every eye closed, nobody looking around, would you be honest enough to say, Brother Perkins, I'd like for you to pray. Would you pray, remember me? God bless these hands. Hands going up all over the field. Because people want to be right. It is a soul that's crying out, take me back to Jesus. Take me back to the sin of debauchery. I promise you, I'll be praying for you this week. Every hand that was raised, I promise you, I'll be praying for you this week. That God will open your understanding and give you a desire. He said, no man repents unless God grants him repentance. I will pray that God will grant you repentance. Lord, bless you for being here. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. God, I said it the way you gave it to me. I pray that this message will burn in their hearts. Brother Zeno's blessing this morning will burn in our hearts. And that we will understand that you are coming soon. And the next great event could take our loved ones out and they would die lost. Don't let us sleep. Don't let us rest. Too many times, God, we pray, don't let the sinner, but I'm asking, don't let me rest until I see these souls that you laid upon my heart and an altar of repentance filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Keep your hands upon everyone. Take a hold, Savior. We ask it in the lovely name of Jesus. And let us be ready. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Don't forget prayer.